Hey guys, I'm hoping to do an update on my Say Cheese group build entry. Hoping it's not going to take a really long time to do it. But there's a couple of things I'm going to talk about before I get to it. If you're wondering about the camera angle or the camera period, it's because I'm trying out a new camera. I bought a new webcam to replace my old Logitech Orbisphere because I noticed Clem Day from Outback Mini Models. He was in a hangout with us there. Couple of days ago, and I was watching what he was doing on his camera, and I noticed that his camera was really clear, and I could see what he was doing really well. And I asked him, "What the hell are you using for a webcam, dude? Because it's like wonderful." So he told me it was a Logitech HD Pro webcam C920. I went, "Oh shit, that sounds expensive." And he said, "No, it'll cost $100 Australian." So I was like, "Oh, cool. Okay." And I know that Clem, he films some of his videos that he uploads to like Facebook and YouTube and stuff. He films them with either his phone or he does it with his webcam. And the quality seems really good. So I thought I'd see if I could find one of these things. And I found one and it was like $98 shipped. And so I bought one and it got here surprisingly in 4 days, which really surprised me because usually nothing takes 4 days in Canada. But I was expecting 2 weeks, but surprise. So it got here, and I thought, well, I know it'll probably increase my video quality for Hangouts. That's probably a given, but I haven't tried it yet. But I wanted to see if it would do any good filming regular videos for my YouTube channel. So I thought I'd give it a try. Now I've noticed a couple of things about it. Like this is what I've been using for the last, I guess, 4 years to film all my videos, and that's this thing. I've had this thing for about maybe 8 years now. It's a Sony Handycam, and I mean, it's a good camera. I mean, it does everything that I needed it to do, but there are some disadvantages to it. The screen's a little small, so it's difficult to see, right? When you're sitting like 4 and 5 feet away when you're trying to build something or work on something, so the camera's like over your shoulder and stuff like that. I mean, this thing spins around, and so you can see it from different angles and stuff like that. But sometimes when you do that, this thing shuts off, which turns off the camera. It does that because I dropped this camera in a cup of coffee once, totally immersing it. I managed to save it by soaking it in rice for a couple of weeks, and but it didn't completely come back. I mean, it doesn't charge the battery very well anymore, and the screen doesn't come on and stay on all the time. So it's not incredibly reliable that way. It still takes really good video, and it still does really good sound. I mean, it's stereo sound and stuff like that. So it's still a decent camera. I mean, the thing cost $600 when I bought it, so it's probably going to be a decent camera for a really long time. Now, there are disadvantages to this camera as well. One of them is right now present because these guys keep going blurry on me because it has trouble handling depth of field, right? It's not very good at it. One of the things I noticed that it does, if I do this to the Handycam, it just focuses instantly on that detail that's on the bottom of that. This thing takes a second or two. And if I do this, it takes a long time to focus on that. The Handycam doesn't do that. It focuses instantly, right? So, and if I do that again, it takes time and time. That's slow compared to the Handycam where it does it almost instantly. Another thing that the Handycam does that this thing doesn't, if I do this, it doesn't focus on them. I have to put my hand behind them. Now it focuses. Right, so it keeps them locked in, sort of, but it's struggling. The Handycam doesn't do that. It just focuses on it. It handles depth of field really well. So that's a disadvantage. So that means it will be difficult to film how-to videos and stuff with this camera. And I've noticed that the sound is a bit more muffled than the Handycam. So one thing that I will probably do is I'll still use the Handycam to film the bulk of my stuff, but I might use this thing to film from a second angle for some videos, for some things, because it's really good for, I can get this thing really close to do close-in work because it's so small, and I can see what I'm doing because it's on the computer monitor. I can see really well, right? Where the display on the Handycam is very small, it's very difficult to see. So I may just use them in concert. So that's why I sound a little different and why the camera looks a little different and that sort of thing. So thought I'd just explain that. Probably you guys had no interest in that whatsoever, but some people do, some people don't. So anyway, all I've gotten done so far for the Say Cheese group build is I built these figures, and I built this recently just broken part of the lower hull. I just pulled all this photo etch off by accident with my fingers. So anyway, I just started building that, and that's just yesterday morning on that. So I haven't done a whole lot as yet. The figures took quite a while to build. Basically, they took a whole morning to do. And well, there's some interesting things about those figures. These are Masterbox, these fellows here. These guys are Dragon Styrene, and these guys are Stalingrad figures. The Masterbox figures were interesting. They have gigantic heads, right? The detail on the figures themselves is all right, but the heads are huge. Now, I haven't done the seam filling yet on them, so the joins around the arms and stuff are still open and everything. And there's still a little bit of cleanup that needs to be done on them, and I still need to make the weapon slings. But, you know, for the most part, though, the detail on the figures themselves isn't so bad. But the heads are huge. They barely even fit inside the helmets. I don't know why they did that, right? It's bizarre. The weapon set that comes with this kit is magnificent. It's better than Dragon's Gen 2. They're absolutely wonderful, the detail on them. But the heads are crazy. They're crazy huge. They're like Tamiya-esque in their bizarreness. So I don't know what happened there. Usually Masterbox is a little bit better than that, but these guys really dropped the ball on those heads. I wish I had some Hornet heads to replace them with. I would have, because those look like crap. The DS Styrene figures, I didn't like at all. I mean, the detail is okay, right? For the most part, the detail is all right. It's a little soft and spongy, but working with the DS Styrene was really tricky. Removing the part lines or mold seams was a pain in the arse. You can't really go at it with a sander very well, and you can't really go at it with a hobby knife either, because the hobby knife will bite in a lot harder than what you think and take away a lot more plastic than you think. So you can't scrape them away like you can on regular styrene. You got to take a little bit of like Mr. Hobby thinner or Mr. Color thinner or a little bit of Tamiya Extra Thin and run it along where the mold line is. As long as it's not too big, it'll melt it away. You got to be careful though, because it's dangerous. But that's what they suggest to use. And so I didn't care much for that. I mean, it's fine on clothing. It's supposed to be a little rough looking and stuff. But on skin, it's supposed to be kind of smooth. So it was really irritating to work on these. I don't think I'll probably build DS Styrene figures again. And they're rubber. So, I mean, if you look, watch. I mean, this guy bends, right? I mean, that's probably good for fitting him in a vehicle and stuff like that. But once you get him painted and do that, there's a good chance you're going to crack the paint and it's going to fall off. You don't want that to happen. So I don't think I'll build DS Styrene figures again. These fellows are, you would think anyway, they're Stalingrad figures, but they're actually not. These are recasts. Dun, dun, dun. But I didn't, well, I kind of sort of guessed they were recasts when I bought them. But a friend of mine saw them on AliExpress on, it was like a Chinese eBay, and they were like crazy cheap. And so I said, geez, it was a 10 figure set. Yeah, I'll buy those. But I had a suspicion that they might be recast. Well, I didn't have any real experience with them at the time. Like I'd heard of people doing it, but I thought it was really rare and stuff like that. So I didn't know for sure. I mean, you know, the photos that were used on the ad were photos of the box art. So there wasn't anything on the ad that would say these are recasts or anything other than they were really cheap. So I bought them and, you know, I didn't even think they were actually going to show up. And I thought I was just going to lose my money. But eventually they showed up. And as soon as I opened the box and I took one look at them, I went, whoa, yeah, those are recasts. Holy crap. It was a 10 figure set. And of the 10 figures, only three of them were actually buildable. These three. Right. The rest are just, they're garbage, melted plastic. I can't even use them for like, you know, casualties or anything like that. They're just terrible. So I wasted my money. You know, they were cheap, but they weren't free. So, you know, I did spend money to buy them and, you know, I wasted my money on that. I feel guilty because I bought them and, you know, they're recasts. I mean, if you don't know what a recast is, it's basically someone out, like bought some Alpine figures or Stalingrad figures or Black Dog figures, brought them home, took the kit apart, and made molds of all the parts that were in the boxes and then cast them, right? And then reboxed them all in little baggies and put them together and sold them on eBay. That's what they did. They basically, it's the same thing as like pirating video or music and stuff, but you're doing it with figures. It's the same thing. And now the legalities of it are somewhat vague because some of these guys don't copyright their figures and stuff, and so it's difficult to do anything about it. But even if they could, I don't know if they would, because it's international, and international law about this kind of thing is ambiguous a lot of the time. So, but either way, we shouldn't be buying recasts at all because it really hurts us. Because the guys who did the original artwork, they're not making any money. And the reason why they're doing it is to make money. So if they're not making money anymore, they're just going to stop doing it, which takes the entire thing out of our hands at all. Like, we're just not getting anything out of it. So I won't be buying any more of these ever. And I feel bad that I bought these at all. I had my suspicions, like I said, when I bought them, but I didn't know for sure until I opened the box. But I know now. I won't be doing that ever again. And I'll make sure that it's reputable dealers is who I buy them from. And I won't be buying these recast crap anymore. I mean, I got screwed, and I screwed the original artist at the same time. So, nobody won. Except for the guy who did the recast. He won. He walked off with my money. And I guess the original artist, he walked off with some of his too, in a way. So yeah, he won. No, I don't like that, so I'm not gonna do it again. What was the other thing? So yeah, so anyway, that was the interesting thing about that. The other thing that I'm having a little bit of trouble with is I could actually use a bit of help with it. Is this the photograph that I'm using to build my scene? And if you look, there you can't really see any unit markings in the photograph other than a small marking on the front of the half tracks. That's the only thing you can see that's like an identifiable marking. Now, the photograph, when I found it, was on a website that was just talking in general about the 251. It didn't specifically annotate the photograph, so there was no identifying features. It didn't say where the photo was taken or who was in it or where it was taken or anything like that. So I mean, I look at the photo and I see it was done in winter. It looks like it might be mid to late war and maybe Eastern Front. I don't have any confirmation on most of that other than it's winter. So I don't really know. If and I've looked and I can't find the photo anywhere else, right? I can't find it in any of my books that I've gone through so far, and I've gone through a fair amount of them. And I'm not going to go through every book I have trying to find this photo. And I've gone through quite a bit of my resource material on the internet trying to find this photo, and I can't find another copy of it. So, if any of you guys can identify what's in this photo, I would really appreciate any help you could provide. If you could send me a like a personal message through YouTube, just go to the About tab on my YouTube channel and click Send Message. Or you can go to the Facebook page, my Facebook page. That's accessible through, through the addresses below in the description. Just click on that and go to my Facebook page and send me a message through that. It would be really appreciated because, I could use a bit of hand on that. They're mostly just because I want to know if I, what the markings are on the side of these half tracks, if any. Worst case scenario, I won't put any on the sides. I don't want to do it that way, but I'll put the one on the front, but that's it. That'll be the worst case scenario. So we'll see what happens. If you guys know, that would be great. You'd have my thanks for that. So the other thing that I'm puzzling myself over is scope when it comes to the diorama. Scope in a diorama when you're dealing with a photograph is always a tricky thing to do. When you look at a photograph and you want to build from that photograph, you have to decide what elements in that photograph you're actually going to deal with and what you're going to cast aside. So, like here's a couple of builds that I've done that are from photos. Some are good, some are bad, and they're ranged over, all the years that I've been building now. So they're, an assortment of skill levels and stuff. But some are recent and some are not. But you know, there's oftentimes there's you have a bit of difficulty deciding what from the photograph you're going to actually use and what you can't. So let's say, well, this you just saw it, but this photo here. In this photograph, you see a Sherman jumbo, a Sherman 76 millimeter wet, and behind that a Willys Jeep, and far in the distance you see a chateau. And in front of that chateau, there's a large tree. Now, if when I built this scene, I built it with the idea that you're going to look at it from the front, right? Now, I can't put it on my shelf that way because it would stick out into the room because it's a long diorama. If you look at this diorama as it sits on the shelf, it looks kind of weird because everything, there's big spaces between everything, right? It's actually right behind me. But I tried to get it so that even if you look at it from the side, it doesn't look too bad. But it there's gaps, there's voids. And when you build dioramas, you try not to do that, right? But this is built from a photograph, so I'm trying to get the proportions and the distances correct so that they roughly correspond with what appears in the photograph. And the photograph is taken from a specific angle along a line of sight. So I'm trying to mimic that line of sight. But I have to cut off certain things and not include them in my diorama because it's just not achievable. It's beyond my ability to build. I could probably try to build that chateau, and I could probably try to build that great, it looks like an oak tree, I think. That's in front of the house. Or it might be an elm, I'm not sure. Or in front of the chateau. But it's huge. I mean, that chateau is probably diorama scale size wise, is probably maybe a foot square, maybe almost a foot high, 3/4 of a foot high. And the trees even looks like it might be even bigger, right? If it's an oak tree, a full adult oak tree can be 3 feet tall and a foot across at 35th scale, like enormous, gigantic. You imagine putting leaves on that thing, right? Like this monstrous trees, these things are. And like Douglas fir trees, huge, monstrous things, right? And trying to model those things at 35th scale is problematic, right? And then trying to imagine trying to move one of these things to a diorama or to a model show is crazy. So I had to decide what I was going to cut off, where my cutoff point was, what I was going to include, what my focus was going to be, and what my scope was going to be. So I decided I would do the road and the three vehicles I could see and a few of the figures that I could see, and then cut it off at that. Because if I tried to build that chateau, my diorama went from maybe, well, it's almost a meter long, right? It would go from being almost a meter long to maybe 2 meters, because the distance between that jumbo that you see in the foreground and that chateau might looks like it's about maybe 400 feet. That's huge, huge on a diorama. And in between those things is nothing but hillside, right? Like barren, just bush and scrub and stuff. It would be a very uninteresting diorama. It would just look boring. It would look like two dioramas kind of stuck together, one of the chateau and then one of the three vehicles, because there's really nothing in between them. So I had to go, okay, there's the cutoff point. And it's directly behind the Willys Jeep. So you have to be able to identify stuff like that. And it's not always easy. Sometimes you don't have to do it. Sometimes it's a very small picture of a guy in a doorway and you're doing that. That's much easier to do. But if you're doing something like, you know, a bunch of guys walking across the field, you have to realize that there is a distance that you have to cut it off at. So otherwise you're modeling mountains that are 30 kilometers away. You don't want to do that. It's possible. You can do it with photos, right? Like backdrops and stuff like that. I've seen people do it very cleverly and very successfully. So but you know, you have to plan it and then have to consider it and stuff like that. So you learn all kinds of really interesting skills that you never tried to do before. And you had to think about things in a way that you're not used to thinking about them before when it comes to scope and stuff like that. So this whole say cheese group build thing really got my juices flowing because building from photographs is an interesting concept, an interesting skill set that modelers often try to do, but they think about it and they don't actually do it and stuff. They lost sometimes. They just go, I want to build this tank, and they open the box and they build it. They don't necessarily build what they see in a photograph. So it's an interesting challenge. So I really look forward to doing this kind of thing. So something I always enjoyed. So But anyway, that's enough about that. The last thing I wanted to talk about, now that most of you guys have tuned out and left the building, this, I want to say a special thanks to someone who kind of went well above and beyond the call of duty, at least in my mind. They really couldn't have done anything more to be a good person, in my opinion. His name's Dustin, and that's him there, Hinterland Customs. You guys probably, a lot of you guys probably know him. This is a shop card, and this is something that a lot of the guys are in the auto genre, I believe it is, that they trade these things around, they put them up in their caves and stuff like that, they mail them to each other. I think these things are damn clever, right? I really like this thing. It's pretty freaking cool. I mean, Dustin's an auto guy, but you know, this is a Mark One tank that he just finished doing, and you know, it looks pretty brilliant in that, right? It's really well done, and there's a thing on the back too, right? And he sent me this one, and then there's a magnetic one that, like, you can stick on your fridge. I had it stuck on my fridge for a while, but my son kept taking it off and playing with it, so I took it away from him, and it's now stuck on the compressor tank for my airbrush. But yeah, so this sits over by my paint shelf here in my cave, so I see it all the time. So you're always on my mind, as Willie Nelson likes to say. That wasn't creepy at all, Dustin. Anyway, but anyway, so that was pretty slick. He sent me that, and so I was really chuffed to see that, and very surprised, and you know, I thought that was pretty neat. Then I got a package from him as well. Now I knew this was coming, and I had a very rough idea as to what was in it, but I was floored by what happened when I opened it. Now, the first thing that I'll talk about, it's not the first thing that I saw when I opened the package, but it's the first thing that I'll talk about. This was in there, right? He apparently heard me and a bunch of fellows talking about these things in a hangout one time. These are sprue cutters from God Hand, right? It's kind of like the Porsche of sprue cutters, apparently. I know a little bit about these. I've seen people talk about them, and I've seen them doing reviews of them and stuff like that. They're very expensive, right? At least for me to buy anyway, they're very expensive. Up anywhere from $45 to $75, depending on where you try to buy them from. They could probably go cheaper, depending on where you shop and stuff. And I only did a quick look around just now to see, you know, how much it would cost. That's, you know, the first couple of places I looked, that's what they wanted to sell them for. They're not cheap. They're extremely high quality. They're very expensive, and they're fairly well made, right? There are some disadvantages to them, but you know, for the purposes that I'll be using these things, they certainly fit the bill. Now, what I've been using for sprue cutters for ages and ages and ages are these little guys here. I think these are called the 410s. They're by Xeron, right? They're very popular, they're very good quality, and they do the job certainly very well. They last a good long time, and you know, when they do the cut, they tend to do a fairly good one. It tends to cut more than it crushes, which is always a good thing. And they're reasonably priced. I mean, I bought these for $12 off Amazon Canada. So, I mean, that's really cheap. But recently I upgraded them to a larger version of the Xeron sprue cutter. It's very much the same, but they fit better in my hand. And they have a slightly narrower tip, and they cut larger pieces of plastic, which is the main reason why I bought it. I don't know what this model number is. They're a little bit more expensive. These are like $19 on Amazon Canada. So, you know, it's only a couple more bucks for these. And the quality is the same. You know, they're very good quality. They last a good long time, and, you know, they do the job that they're meant to do. But because they're larger, and the other ones are also large, I find it difficult to cut very, very tiny parts off of the sprues. They tend to either crush it. When they bring the plastic together, they tend to crush, like grab handles are the worst. They fold the grab handle as they're cutting it. Even if you cut it from the side, it still tends to do it sometimes. I just can't get the tool in there because it's too tight to the sprue, right? So a long time ago, I got myself one of these from Micromark, right? They're handy and they were doing the job. They're good for cutting out very tiny parts. Of course, the camera's not focusing on anything now. They're good for cutting out very tiny parts off the sprues and stuff like that, but there are some disadvantages to it as well. There's some machining issues with it. The top plane here isn't exactly flat. Instead of coming together like this, it's got a bit of a dip to it like that, so it makes it difficult to sharpen it. Sometimes when you're sharpening it, it ends up like this, right? Or like this, and you want it to come together nice and neat. And when it comes together, it dulls itself because it's, you know, two bare blades coming together like that. And it's not very hard. It tends to dull rather quickly. So sharpening it is a bit of a problem. And sometimes you really have to squeeze really hard with some densities of plastic in order to get it. And when you do that, sometimes ping, the part is gone and you spend an hour looking for it. But for what it is, it's actually a pretty clever tool. Maybe if it was just a little bit better machined, or maybe the metal was a bit better quality or something like that, I don't really know what it would take to improve it. But for what it is, it doesn't do the job too badly. All right. So, you know, I would, if this was just slightly better quality, I think, but I don't really know how to define what quality it is I'm looking for. Maybe make it so that this part here comes together better and it sharpens better, or at least holds the edge longer, right? Maybe it would work, but it does get in there and it does clip off the parts that are difficult to reach. It does do that. So, but that is being replaced by this, because this thing gets in there no friggin' problem whatsoever and just whoop, cuts it right off like nothing. Handles the bigger plastic too. It cuts through plastic like nothing, and it leaves a nice clean edge as well. It's very flush cut. So it's a very well made tool. It does have one problem that I don't much care for. When I'm using it, I hold it a specific way because I'm used to holding these tools a specific way. When I close it grabs my skin because of the way it has this instep here, right? That little part tends to grab me where these ones don't, because it doesn't have it. So that's the only thing I don't much care for, because there, it's got me, right? It'll do that sometimes. Not usually a huge amount, but enough that it's a kind of annoying. So I have to hold them a very specific way, in a way that's kind of a bit annoying. Because they're so small, I tend to drop them. So, but other than that, I mean, the tool is brilliant. And I imagine if you get a larger size of these things, they would be just as good quality, but expensive. So anyway, Dustin, thank you for that. It's a brilliant tool and I really appreciate it. And dude, your generosity is boundless for even sending that to me. And I don't have words, but that's not the least of it. When Dustin heard that, last summer, my oldest son passed away, and he felt quite terrible about that. He took it upon himself to start a project, kind of a commemoration. And he did quite a bit pulling this thing together, looking hell and high water, trying to find all the elements that he wanted to use. And he pulled this thing together. I won't show it to you because it's a bit private, but I'll, you know, he went well out of the way to build this little commemoration piece that pretty much captures my boy all the way through, right from beginning to end. It does, it captures him. And he, at no small expense, put all this together and shipped it to me all the way from where Dustin lives. And it cost him to do. And I don't have words to thank him. I really don't. When we opened that package, there wasn't a dry eye in the room. We were all quite overwhelmed, and it meant a lot. It really did. So, it gives me hope that not everyone in our community is a floating bag of shit. That there are a lot of us, and they're the silent ones. That they're good quality, generous people that will literally reach out and touch someone. And so that was really cool. So I don't have words, Dustin. I really don't. You shut me right the hell up as soon as I opened that box that I had nothing. I still don't. It still gets me when I think about it. So you blew me away, buddy. That's all I can say. You blew me away. It meant a lot, and it will for a long time. It sits in a place of honor in my living room, and it's going to sit there for a very, very, very long time, my friend. So, thank you. You're a good doobie. Anyway, I don't have anything else I want to talk about. I'm going to probably push on and do something here at the bench for a while. So I'm going to take off. So you guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. I'll talk to you soon. Bye for now. Mm-hmm.